Hey, Dr. C with you. So when should you be worried about your blood test results? This is important. So in the recent past, more and more often consumers have access to their test results. You know, in fact, in a lot of cases, they see them before the doctor does. We've got all these electronic medical records, these patient portals, and yeah, oftentimes you'll see them before we do, patients and doctors. The other big trend is patient direct labs. So people can acquire, you know, order, purchase, and do their own test results, their own tests, and they can get results themselves that a doctor may never see. So these are very common. And with that, it's just normal that there's going to be more anxiety present and more worry and times in which you've got to make sense out of that. So what I want to talk about is just really, in these situations, when is it the most significant? When would you really need to worry? And this is important because a lot of things can be abnormal and not be worrisome. And on the other hand, some things can be normal, but still significant. So I want to throw that out there. And of course, the message here is you want to have a trusted relationship with a doctor. You want to work with someone that you trust their knowledge and you trust their care for you. There's no way around that. You know, a really popular question that I've heard before was, you know, what test should I get done or what test should I ask my doctor to run? The way I think about that is like you're getting on an airplane and you say, well, how should I tell the pilot to turn on the airplane? What should I tell my pilot to do to start the airplane? Like, if you got to tell him how to start the airplane, yeah, that's not good because there's a lot more to it than that. And same thing about ordering lab tests. If you got to tell your doctor what to order, well, there's no end to it. You know, there's going to be interpreting the results. There's going to be doing the treatment. There's going to be the follow-up. That's just the very beginning of all of it. So yeah, you need to have someone you can trust. And here's a really important point, too, along those lines. There's been this popular idea that what test should you request for your thyroid or for this, that, or the other? And it's almost like the longer the list is, the better your doctor is serving you. And if they didn't test every single thing on some list, then they're ignorant or they don't care. But it's not true. It's possible they're ignorant, but it's also possible they're aware of the fact that more tests don't mean better data. So if you don't test something and there's a problem, it could mean that a problem went undiscovered and went undiagnosed. Totally true. On the other hand, if you test something that's not relevant, there's always a certain rate of a false positive that can always happen. And the more irrelevant things you test, the more false positives you'll have. And either you ignore them or you do other follow-up tests which never were necessary. And some might end up being invasive. So yeah, better doctors don't always test more. And same thing with yourself. When you're selecting tests for yourself to do or requesting from your doctor, more is not always better. But as a starting place, when to worry, anything abnormal that's out of range should be explained and should be made sense out of. Now again, not every abnormal is truly a problem. There's a lot of things that sometimes a lab may have a blood tube that's processed incorrectly, or it sits too long. And this can cause a large number of abnormalities. These are generally recognizable in a pattern and in the clinical context. So lab interpretation really comes down to taking into account all the factors of you, your health, your symptoms, your past findings, your history, your expectations, and putting that together. I'll talk about some particulars, but again, this comes down to really working with someone who can take that big picture idea and do that in a way that you trust and feel good about. So a couple of things. So abnormal findings, you want an explanation for those always. But the explanation may not be you. It may not be a problem with you. It can be a glitch in the lab. And there's some things to where they're abnormal, but for reasons that are not relevant. For example, if a fasting glucose level is measured on someone who's not fasting, if they just had a meal, their glucose will be elevated, but it doesn't mean they've got a problem. So the context matters quite a bit. Also with thyroid tests, if someone recently took a dose of thyroid medication, they may have abnormally high levels of T3 or T4, but they may not be taking too much. It may totally be a function of the overall timing. So that's about abnormals. They always need an explanation, but know that they're not always bad and not always worrisome. There's a few tests I want to talk about that can be important, even when the results are normal. And these are especially significant for that reason. So of these things that can be significant even when they're normal, the first I want to mention is calcium. So calcium in the blood is measured via serum calcium. And it sounds like a really benign, harmless thing. Like, well, calcium, you know, you have more of it. You take less of it, whatever. But no, calcium in the blood shows your body's calcium regulatory processes. It doesn't show your status of calcium intake. It shows how your body controls calcium in the blood. And that's super critical. If that deviates slightly, we can't beat our heart. We can't send signals through our nerves. So it's a very big deal. When calcium is high, that always begs an explanation. If someone says you've got high calcium and not to worry about it, that's time to get another opinion because it's always significant. But it may be significant even when it is normal. So specifically, when we're seeing it above 9.8 or greater, it can be a sign of abnormal parathyroid function. It's not always, but it can be. So if it is there, and if there are unexplained symptoms, such as fatigue or anxiety or joint pain or irritable bowel or muscle pain, it's worth looking further to see if that's significant or not. Another big one is one of the main liver enzymes called ALT, alanine aminotransferase. The normal ranges have gotten narrower, which is good, but within the normal range, levels that are on the higher side of normal are clearly a problem. Specifically, women who have scores greater than 19 or men who have scores greater than 25. Most labs say that normal goes up to mid-30s or low 40s. Not that long ago, they said mid-60s, but now they've come down a bit. But you can still be above that 19 or 25 and have there be something wrong. Now, it's not always the same thing that causes that, but that does warrant an explanation. The most common culprit being fatty liver, but if ALT is above that threshold, it's worth following through on. Next up is TSH. This is one of the thyroid tests, and there's just lots of data saying that healthy people have lower TSH scores on the low side of normal, not just the normal range. So the normal range now from labs is between about 0.4 to 4.5 or 4.2. Some are saying 4.2 now. But healthy people tend to have TSH scores that are more on the bottom end of that, like 0.4 to 1.9 or 2.0 or 1.5, somewhere around there. It differs per the study. Now, this doesn't always mean that everyone who's above 2 needs medicine, but it does mean that people who are above 2, this could be a problem. It may be contributing to symptoms at present, and it may cause future issues it may be worth looking at a more detailed way. So TSH is a strong example to where normal can still be something that may require worrying about and looking through at more closely. Related to that would be thyroid antibodies. So in many cases, these are not measured, or they're measured and they're positive, but they're below some threshold. So thyroid antibodies, they're significant. They show that the body is attacking the thyroid. And even with normal thyroid function, they can independently cause symptoms. So when someone says your antibodies are high, but your thyroid's normal, not to worry about it, it can be causing problems. It likely doesn't mean you would benefit from medication, but it does warrant being treated in some way. Next up would be ferritin. This is a marker of iron storage. Now, this one's tricky because a lot of things can falsely elevate it. Any chronic cause of inflammation in the body can cause ferritin levels to run high, so just do know that. But if someone has thyroid disease, they may have symptoms of low iron even with normal ferritin. So if ferritin gets below somewhere like 50 or 60, they may be symptomatic. And that can include fatigue, hair loss, headaches, poor quality sleep, muscle pain. That can be a lot of very important symptoms. We really think about this being relevant for menstruating women. But yes, ferritin may need to be addressed even if it is normal. So a few more thoughts about blood tests. So what can show up and how can things change randomly? Well, it's important to realize that there can be times to where levels just go up and down for no clear reason. And I was just talking to some medical interns yesterday, and they were asking about a particular abnormal finding. And I said, well, did you recheck it? That's the first question. So often weird things show up, but they don't show up again, and they may never show up again. So many odd findings can be just that, a one-off. So before you put any worry or thought into something, just recheck. And some things would warrant a little more time for a retest because it takes longer to see that randomness go away. But think about like a few weeks, a few months maybe, but with guidance, consider a retest. And before taking big steps on any abnormality, see if it's still there with a retest. Another consideration is just lab error. So I have seen times to where labs have mistaken samples and gotten the wrong results for the wrong patient. There are also ways, like I mentioned, to where the way lab tests are processed, the specimen may be mishandled. So these things can happen as well. And this is another justification for considering a retest before putting too much weight on one particular finding. Now, another big thing you might not think about is exercise, you know, brisk exercise. If you do a hard workout, a lot of things are different in your body for a couple of days. So you can have more inflammation, you can have broken down blood cells, you can have immune changes, you can have differences in blood sugar, liver enzymes. That all happens. And none of those things show that exercise are bad, but they're showing your body is undergoing an adaptive stress response. So they can occur. But if you do a hard workout, you shouldn't do your blood tests in the following days afterward. Similarly, recent illnesses. If you just had some cold, some respiratory infection, you were off in some way, that can goof up your blood results for even several weeks. So be aware of that. And then finally, weight changes. If your weight is going up or down, that can shift quite a bit with your chemistry. So important thing to take into account and share with your providers. So how do you get better results? How do you make more sense of those? Well, the critical thing is to always know that the trends matter more than isolated readings. So it's not the one thing that showed up. It's the trend over time that we put a lot of weight in. And it's also critical to know that these things only matter in the context of all other facets of your health. People that are perfectly healthy always have a few things that are going to look abnormal. And part of that is random, part of that is ranges that are too narrow or too broad. But healthy people always have things that are off, but they're not always relevant. So it's critical to know that both ways can need to be taken into account. And then the big thing is really that you need a good relationship with a doctor. You need someone you trust. And you need to know that more testing is not always better. That sometimes things may show up, but they're not significant. We have the technology to measure things at levels far below amounts that actually do harm us. So some things that are measurable may not be doing anything at all. So it's not just a matter of checking everything, it's checking the right things. You want a good doctor that will check the right things for you, not too much, not too little. They won't ignore normal things that are still significant, and they also won't overreact to abnormal things that are not significant. But yeah, Dr. C with you. It's important to screen, to be aware of your health, to follow up on things and understand the causes of symptoms. And you need that done well and accurately. All right, take good care. We'll talk again soon.